Traditional approach in robotics is sense, plan, act. There are sensors sensing the environment, a model of the environment is established, and within this model a plan is generated. Out of this plan come trajectories that are sent to the robot to act. This approach, however, requires extensive calibration, and it's also a limited flexibility. Once planned, it cannot be changed, or at least it can only be changed in a much shorter timeline. Therefore, we want to go towards a skill-based approach where we plan in terms of skills. And we plan in terms of act-sense combinations that are reactive. In this way, we can avoid many of the calibration issues, because for the skills, we have typically local sensor measurements instead of global absolute positioning. And this makes it more robust. And it's also very quick and reactive, such that we can deal with variable environments where there is a human intervention or interaction. So an example is, for example, the force-based assembly of a rotor in a screw compressor. And we have made here a plan in terms of skills. And you have seen these rotors here. They have a certain geometry on top, and they only fit with a certain orientation, rotation around the axis of the rotor. But instead of trying to determine this with a vision system, the system solves this by implementing a skill that turns until the screw compressor drops. In this way, specifying a task in terms of basic skills is much more robust than a global vision system that's very sensitive to calibration systems and accuracies of the sensors. Another example is a cheese decrusting application. The purpose of this application is to remove the crust from a cheese. Of course, this cheese is a natural product and has an irregular shape that also varies between item by item. At the same time, we want to remove this crust very accurately. Because if you, for example, cut 1 millimeter too much cheese, this already corresponds to 3% of the cheese that has been removed. So if you see its economic impact, that's 3% of the turnover of that cheese production company. So that's a lot of money. So we want to accurately remove the crust of this cheese. And traditionally, this is done by having a measurement cell where the cheese runs through and a 3D sensor is capturing the geometry of the cheese, and then it goes to a conveyor belt towards a robot cell where then the cheese is decrusted based upon the information of this measurement cell. You see already you have two separate cells connected with a conveyor belt, and you need absolute positioning for both the measurement cell and the robot. And calibration issues are a big problem in such a setup. And this setup, in fact, follows the traditional sense, plan, act approach. Our approach is more planning in terms of skills. And we have a crust removal skill, and we plan the complete task in function of these skills. And this crust removal skill consists of three laser distance sensors that scan the surface of the cheese, model the surface of the cheese, and then follow this model trajectory, while at the same time making sure that the laser distance sensors keep in range of their measurement range. In this way, we can remove the cheese at high speed without having any problems with calibration errors. Only the tool itself needs to be accurate. We don't really need very accurate absolute positioning of the robot. We are going to implement these skills or behaviors using a constraint-based approach, and more specifically a task function approach. This task function is an expression of what we want to maintain or achieve. This can be something related to the geometry of the task, such as maintaining some distance, but it can also be something related to the input sensors of the robot system. This task function is a function of a number of variables representing the state of the system. In our approach, this can be robot joint variables, but can also be feature variables. And I will discuss these feature variables later. So Q are both joint variables and feature variables. This task function is also dependent explicitly on time. It's also important to note that we specify the behavior of this task function. We don't specify an immediate constraint on the value of this task function. That would also not be possible in a reactive context. So, to specify this behavior towards a certain target, we can do this in a first order system by writing down this first order system and specifying this behavior using a control stop constant k. We can also do this in a second order, with a second order system, where we then specify the behavior using a pulsation and a damping factor. Take again this first order system. We can expand these total time derivatives towards time into partial derivatives towards q and the x time and partial derivatives towards time. And then we can interpret these partial derivatives on one hand as a Jacobian, and these are the partial derivatives towards the joint variables q. And the partial derivative towards time, the explicit dependency on time, it's related to the feed-forward term of this controller. And then we also have this k times e, which is in fact a kind of feedback term. Of course, we can also use the same approach with inequalities by just replacing the equality with an inequality. If we then, for a certain task, assemble all the constraints, we can put them in a list and we can impose that they need to be satisfied all at the same time. Of course, this will not always be possible. Constraints can be conflicting. In order to deal with this, we sometimes add for soft constraints an additional slack variable, epsilon, such that we can give some margin when constraints are conflicting. Then we need of course, to compute this q dot, and this q dot is computed using an optimization problem, which minimizes the weighted sum of these slack variables. And just to be sure that we can deal with singularities and so on, we use also an additional regularization term, and this exactly corresponds to the behavior of a damped least square pseudo-inverse that's well known in robotics.